Welcome to the episode number 48 of the Introvert Biz Growth Podcast, the show where I talk to introverts who grow their business and make a difference. I'm Sarah Zanacroce, and I'm really happy that you're spending this time with me today. Today, I'm talking to Julienne Desjardins, and I had to ask her how you pronounce that name, because to me, this is, you know, really a French name, and in French, I would pronounce it Julienne Desjardins. And in English, when she told me how to pronounce it, it sounded completely different. So Julienne is a strategist for small business owners and aspiring freelancers. As a certified ConvertKit expert and virtual assistant, she helps small businesses develop and implement plans for their email and social media marketing. Julienne also supports new freelancers and virtual assistants through her coaching and strategy calls. She's a proud work-at-home mom to her 1.5-year-old Luke. So besides my usual questions about running a business as an introvert, we also talked about the topic of being a mompreneur. While I never used the label of mompreneur in my branding, being able to be there for my two boys as they were growing up was definitely one of the reasons why I started my business. And each year I had a little more time to invest in my business while they spent a bit more time at daycare, then kindergarten, and now school. My eldest is now soon to be 15 and my youngest is 11. So yes, they still need me around, but they're, you know, very independent and young adults. And looking back, I'm really just so grateful that I was able to spend these precious years with them. But it isn't all roses and butterflies, and Julienne and I discuss some of the struggles when building your business that way, on the side, so to speak. And I just want to make sure that my male audience doesn't think, oh, this is just like one of those cheesy mompreneur episodes. It's not, because really it also applies if you are someone who's just building their business as a side hustle while still working a day job. So we're not talking about the struggles about, you know, changing diapers and that kind of thing, but more about you know, it has to do with patience and not always comparing yourself to other business owners who really have, you know, 10, 12 hours a day to invest in their business. And so obviously they're growing much faster. But I'm giving it all away. So just listen to our conversation. So here's my chat with Julienne Desjardins. How are you today, Julienne?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much. As we just said offline, we had several tries because we both got sick and had to cancel and reschedule. So I'm so glad to talk to you today, even though now you have a broken finger. So
I know it's that time of the year, although not the broken finger time of the year, but the flu time of the year.
That's
and,
right.
You know, I guess it's always that time of the year for me to be a little klutzy. So.
Well, as I just said, it's a good thing it's not a foot, but then I realized, well, we do need our hands to type. So you said you were using Siri to type all your messages.
I know. Well, I'm a night owl, which I'm sure we'll like talk about. So it's been a little bit awkward because I am kind of like talking to myself, you know, at like 2 a.m. and everyone's kind of, I keep waking the baby up and stuff. But yeah, I didn't even know that your iMac had this feature. So like FYI.
That's great.
It's just that I just double tap a key and she's writing all of my emails out for me for my clients. So that's helped me stay on target. Otherwise, I'd be a complete disaster.
That's awesome. Yeah, I do that sometimes on my treadmill where I just dictate.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've only used it on the phone. She's, you know, God love Siri, but she's just as clunky on the computer as she's on the phone sometimes. But it's working.
It's something. Yeah. Awesome. Well, Julienne, besides your bio that I just read in the intro, maybe you can tell us a little bit more about who you are and, you know, the introvert insider stories about how you built your business and how you're running it as an introvert.
Sure. I started just kind of freelancing, and I don't know if this is an introvert thing or not. It's a me thing, but I was really nervous about putting myself out there. So I come from like nonprofit management. I was used to sort of talking about the team and we anytime I talked about the mission of something. Mm-hmm. And that part was really a little awkward for me. It maybe sometimes still is, but I just kind of got started and kind of clunked along figuring out how to work with local clients where I am now. And, you know, 5 years later, working with people face to face is actually, I have very few clients that are in my local area. So that kind of actually works sort of well because I can just do a video call, separate, do an email, separate, you know, that kind of suits me as a person better. But in general, the highlights are, you know, 5 years ago, started freelancing, working with nonprofits, helping them with grant writing and that kind of thing, what I knew at the time. And then as my skills and training grew into more communications work for the nonprofits I was with, I started freelancing those skills. And about, it's 3 years ago, next month, I went full-time in the business. I have a two-year-old now. So after that, I, you know, was figuring out how to continue grow the business while I was a sick pregnant person and then had a new baby. And so, but it's been nice. I mean, you know, especially for things like you fall down the stairs and break your finger, stuff where you need to take a break, either physically or emotionally. If there's just been too many client hiccups in a day, it's like a full moon day and I need to just step away for my own sanity. You can do that, you know, because you're in charge. So it's been an interesting journey. Some of it is really hard. A lot of it is really hard of being the person in charge of stuff, you know. But in general, it's been really rewarding to have the freedom of choice with my time.
Right. So how did you transition? Because you said you were working for nonprofits and then all of a sudden you're like, okay, I'm not going to be employed anymore. So how did you get your first clients?
I was already working with a small group of clients. And my original plan was to kind of go a couple more years of building the business before I went full time. And I just sort of felt in my gut like I should, this was the right time. So I just started working on getting more folks in my pipeline at that point. I was mostly back then focused just on one-off work. Now I work a lot on retainer, which I can tell you about, but I was just kind of, all right, I gave 60 days notice to my job. I have 2 months to get the next Squarespace build set. You know, I was like booking people out, basically. And then shortly after I went full-time, I found out that I was having a baby. So that was, you know, it was like a long 3-year process for me to be able to have a baby. And then it was just, I didn't think it was going to happen right then. And it was a really interesting process that propelled me because being pregnant gives you this kind of forced deadline. So the fear that I had about putting myself out there for some things, I absolutely, you know, I had to do it then, or I was afraid of what a business would look like after, you know, being a work at home mom. I didn't know what that looked like. So I had to race. So I have like a course for VAs. I finished that before I went on maternity, that kind of thing. But halfway through my pregnancy, I had my baby in December. So about July, I had been afraid of offering retainers. For some reason, it just seems like who is going to want to commit to me every single month? And then I decided, all right, halfway through the summer, let me just do this. And what happened immediately was that my average income that I was bringing in every month doubled right away. And has only gone up from there. But I reached out to the people that were those one-off clients that had already been coming back for a project here and there. And I just said to them, you know, I'm not going to be offering as many spots for one-time work. I'm coming to the people I like the best, which was the truth. And just seeing if you want to work together every single month to, you know, further your business instead of one thing at a time. And a lot of them said yes. And so that's kind of the model that I use still today, is that I'm focused on a handful of clients that are committing to me every month.
Right. Yeah. And so that's what a retainer means, right? For those who have never heard the term, it's basically, is it a VA term or is it just like a contractor term?
Maybe? I mean, you know, I guess it's different from like if you put an attorney on retainer and it's not like they're paying me 10 grand up front or something. Yeah. I offer my clients, so this is how it shakes out. I offer my clients a 5% discount over the one-off. So a client that just comes for 2 hours pays full rate. If you want to knock things off your to-do list every month, you get a discount.
Right.
they have 30 days to use the hours. So my retainers are built on, they're pre-purchasing like 10 or 15 hours for the month. And I reserve that time. So for me, as partly as, you know, I'm introverted, I can only handle so much. You know, I know that about myself. And partly as a work at home mom, I only sell so many retainer spots. I know how many hours I have to work next month, basically.
Right.
And then somebody might use 5 this week and 7 next week or whatever. You know, she's in charge of when she uses those hours in the 30 days. But that's the basic premise of what my retainers look like. You know, everybody can, obviously that's the beauty of being the boss. They can look however you want, but that's how it looks for me.
Right. And so what do you do with the kids? Because they're now 2 and...
Well, the other kids that are around are my brother's 2 kids. So I have just 1 2-year-old.
Okay.
And then there's...
I was reading in the bio her 1.5-year-old. And so I thought it was...
Because we were doing it like that.
That wouldn't quite match up with the 9 months difference. So.
He has since turned 2. But there's actually quite a few kids around because 2 days a week, including today, I am at my mom's house. And they watch my 2-year-old niece and my 4-year-old nephew. And so my son gets time with his best friends and his grandparents. And it's this beautiful thing that's happening out there where they're like making cookies and stuff. And then, you know, I'm in here 2 days a week. And the other days it's nap time and it's working at night, which I am one of those people that kind of feels alive at nighttime. So it's tiring to wake up the next day and be a mom, but my brain sort of works really well late at night. So, you know, it works for me.
It works out. Yeah. Let's talk a bit more about this being a mom thing, because I'm a mom. I started my business when my kids were small, 6 months and 3 years old. And I'm sure there's other people in the community, in the audience, who are moms who start their business. I totally don't regret a thing, and I think it's the best thing I ever did. I always said I built my business alongside my kids while my kids grow up, and that's exactly what happened. And it was nice because I was always there when the kids were sick, and you know, just this week, my eldest stayed home because he was sick. At the same time, though, it was really, really hard not to always compare myself to others. You know, like we're so always bombarded with competition, basically, or other people who are doing these amazing things and building these amazing businesses. And you're like, oh, I just, you know, I wish it would go faster and I could do more. And you just can do everything. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if you kind of struggled with the same thing or if that
Yeah. I mean, there's this thing of like the 4-hour work week or whatever. I mean, that kind of stuff aside, what I have to remind myself is, so those hours that I contract myself out for are part-time. You know, I work between 10 and 15 hours a week and I make more than I was making in my full-time job. So I am really proud of what I've done. Am I making $500,000 a year in my business? No, but I am contributing financially to my household. You know, I'm able to be home with my son and my niece and my nephew. You know, I'm able to be a present figure in their lives. And I can go to the zoo when I want to, or, you know, whatever, man. Like, it's that thing. But I am proud of what I've built. But if I look at, you know, maybe I should be making $500,000 in 4 hours a week, which obviously isn't necessarily the point of the book, but I think people kind of sell it that way. Maybe I should be doing that, or it's all the shoulds and stuff that is not good. And I think that there is starting to be a rising up of voices around the idea that it's just true. Moms just have a few different, whatever the expression is, pots on the fire. So I don't know. But, you know, there's just a few more nuances for a mom. For me, if I leave the office to get a drink of water, I'm still nursing my son. That becomes like a 30-minute, you know, nurse fest if he sees me late at night when he's sleepy. You know what I mean? So other people...
Oh, there's mama. I want my snack.
There's my snack. And other people, you know, it's not right or wrong, but someone who is not a mom doesn't have, and whatever that is for whatever stage your kid is at, you know, homework time, that kind of thing. Someone just doesn't have those extra pieces. It's just, you know, fact. It's not better or worse.
Yeah.
So I think there are some additional things pulling at moms. I think, you know, Sheryl Sandberg talks a lot about this in lean in about needing a 50-50 partner where you're both splitting stuff. So on those days, my husband's making dinner or whatever that looks like. I think that you need, even if you're a single parent, you need some kind of support system. Mm-hmm. But it is easy to kind of look out and see what other people are doing. The other thing that I take solace in is that I am building a business that is, you know, I don't want to say like recession proof, but I can't think of another term. It's not a fad, right? I am trained and I am a skilled implementer in marketing. And that's something that isn't, you know, I didn't have a $10,000 month on some kind of coaching program and then I don't make anything for the rest of the year, right? It's consistent. I'm working with people. I'm creating real outcomes. You know, if you are building something that has real value, you can offer those skills for this audience for this period, you know, this time period. And then later on, if some industry of health coaches, you know, are gone, you can take those skills and re-implement them to someone else.
That's right. It's also a business that keeps growing. I mean, imagine right now you're working only 15 hours a week. Well, imagine if you're going to work 30 hours a week.
Exactly. Once kindergarten hits, you know, then that's the other thing too, is that my husband will remind me of that one a lot, that's the one I forget because I didn't even mention it. Yeah. But kindergarten is soon, as sad as that is. So I think if you're a wedding planner and you're a mom and your business is what it is now, well, in a couple years, what will it be then? And again, it's one of those things where it's not a get rich quick kind of thing. This is something that you're building, mm-hmm. that you own. Yeah. So, you know, it's good to remind ourselves of these things, though,
you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think in the moment, it's risky to compare because you see these people and a lot of them, they either don't have kids or they never had kids or they're just only focusing on their business. And so obviously they're going to progress much faster than you are. So,
right.
For the moms out there, just patience and enjoy the moment, you know, these small months. Yeah.
Because sometimes for me, I have friends that are moms that prefer to pay for full-time childcare. And that is okay, but she's going to have more time on the business in addition, you know, even if she is a mom. So it's all apples and oranges, really, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think like as business owners, at least my perspective is that I have to sometimes like protect my mind from like the creepy critters. I can't look at those threads that talk about income or whatever. I have to just stay focused on what the metrics are that I've set for myself.
Yeah. It's interesting. Thanks for sharing that perspective because I've always never really had too many people in my network that were in the same situation I was. And so I was often, you know, talking to people who didn't have kids and that makes all the difference, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's talk about what I call the introverted superpowers. So what would you say is your biggest strength as an introverted entrepreneur?
Well, I don't know if it's, you know, stereotypical or not, but I think I like to work on my own. So I think being a VA or building out someone's email funnel, I can take all the details that they're sending me from the copywriter, all that stuff, right? Once I get all those pieces, I can sit down, I can hammer everything out. I don't mind late nights alone or early mornings alone. I don't, for the most part, I don't crave like the water cooler days that I had, you know? I had really great work experiences before this part of my journey and I had great friends at my jobs that are still my friends. But that part of it, I was okay leaving behind. And I think some people might miss that more than me, but it just kind of, it works well for me to sort of just be alone in the office is fine.
Definitely an introvert thing. Just to confirm. Yes, definitely. I think we're just, thank God for the internet, right? Because before there really wasn't that much option for that. So,
right.
So what is a challenge though? I mean, being alone is okay, but what would you say is your biggest challenge as an introvert?
Well, I think maybe sometimes like being too alone, you know, I'll notice like if it's a day where my dad has, you know, come and grab my son and they're at the science museum or something like, and I won't have gone outside. I'll realize like the next morning, if it's like a Friday, this happened last week. And on Saturday morning, I said to my husband, like, I haven't been outside since Thursday because I just will sit there. If you leave me alone at the computer, I will sit there for, I think like last Friday was like 15 hours because I get in the zone, you know, and I don't even think. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a time and a place for focus, but I don't think that's very good. So I've kind of let my steps go and all that kind of stuff because I'm just focused in. So I think that's not great. And I think conversely, like the being able to be a self-starter and be alone thing, when you work with clients that have bigger teams, the first few times I did that from transitioning from a solopreneur to a larger team, that was a transition to get back into getting the team, the things that they needed from me. So, you know, the dependencies, right? If she can't start her thing until I have my thing, instead of me like doing teamwork, everything by myself. Yeah. Kind of refocusing or reintroducing myself to the idea of being a team member is okay now. But in the beginning, it was a little bumpy for me. So say those
I think we can be quite impatient and picky, you know, with who we want to spend our time with. And a lot of times we're very efficient and so we get annoyed easily, I think.
That sounds like me. Sure. Because I think particularly like, you know, it's this thing of like, these people are paying me. This is my business. I want everything to go perfectly, you know, mm-hmm. and you take it like super hard. I do. Mm-hmm. If someone isn't totally happy or if something doesn't go completely perfectly.
Well, that I think comes back to the empathy because we really feel for our client. And so we want everything to, you know, to be just right and want mm-hmm. them to be happy. So yeah, that makes a lot of sense to me. Can you take us to an aha moment sometime, either in your business or something that happened before, where, you know, all of a sudden you realized something and everything changed?
Mm-hmm. I think like two stand out for me. A long time ago, I had always, even as a kid, you know, I would like make boondoggle bracelets and sell them and that kind of thing. I always kind of would fantasize, I think, about the idea of like owning a business, but I didn't, I always kind of thought like I would be a lawyer and I'd have my own practice and that would be, you know, my like business. I never really, you know, these skills didn't exist back then, but I kind of always liked the idea. And there was a lot, like I said, that I was afraid of. As corny as it may sound, I was reading Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg and she was saying, what would you do if you weren't afraid? And I, you know, put the book down. I was sitting there next to my husband and I said, I would start a business. What I'm afraid of is I don't know how to find clients. I don't know how to put myself forward. And if I wasn't afraid of those things, this is what I would do. And so he said, well, then, you know, go do it. And that's when I started a blog. I was also kind of nervous about being a woman that was talking about tech in general. I felt a little intimidated. My previous experience in my jobs was like the men did those things, talked about those things. And mm-hmm. I didn't have a ton of examples where women were a part of those conversations. That was my like schema at the time. So I started a blog just talking about stuff that was interesting to me, like in the tech world. And just putting that out there was like the first big breakthrough of like, no one's yelling at me. I don't sound like a total idiot. This is okay. You know? And then it went from there. So just kind of saying like, Dave Ramsey says, what has to be true today for you to achieve that result?
So reading that Lean In book seems like a big event for you.
It was a big deal. And then I would fast forward a couple of years. This is kind of recent, like in 2017 for sure. The idea, this is like a fluke. People are paying me by accident, you know, like it's going to end soon. So I was thinking of it as, all right, I got through my pregnancy year being self-employed. Let's see if I can do it again. Okay. I got through year one. I got through year two. Let's see if I can do it again was my thought process until, you know, fairly recently, the end of last year, you know, middle of last year, where I kind of was like, this is a thing. I'm selling real skills. I'm generating real revenue. Like this is okay to just kind of settle into it and accept the blessing. I struggled with just the fear of it disappearing. And like it still is there, you know, if there's a war or something.
I think it really never goes away, unfortunately. Yeah, yeah. I'm like in year 10 or 11 and it's just still every morning I'm like, I'm so lucky to do what I do.
Yeah. Yeah. It still is always going to be there because you're the person that has to like get the next client.
Yeah.
But like it's severely diminished. And that took, you know, 5 years to... Right. For me to fall into like acceptance.
Yeah.
Acceptance of this really cool thing.
Yeah.
Those are the things that stand out.
Awesome. All right. Let's talk more specifics now. Like I call this question the three golden nuggets. So, what's a personal habit that you do, something you do on a regular basis that you think contributes to your success?
The caveat is I think I need more sleep. However, I think better at night. I always have. So staying up works well for me. And I also counteract that. Like in the morning, my son and I just sleep in, you know, and we, you know, hang out in bed. We'll watch Sesame Street or whatever. But I don't schedule anything either for him or for me in the morning. So the night before, I stay up late because I'm finishing anything that needs to get done so that I can have those mornings with him. It's a recharge for me. He and I get to hang out. It's just a really low pressure way to start the day. And it's not,
I think it's just so important to respect your rhythm, right? It's just how you function. And as long as you get enough sleep, then...
Well, you know, that's a whole nother problem.
However, the thing you need to work on.
Yeah. But in general, I think, you know, the idea of like the early bird gets the worm and you have to, that would be nice. I would, you know, I think I would like to be one of those people that likes to get up in the morning, but I'm not. Mm. So, you know,
I think there's too much pressure and it's kind of like this thing that, what was this book? The Morning
Rich? Miracle Morning.
Yeah. Yeah. Miracle Morning. I'm like, you know, why does it have to be a morning? I'm a morning person. So yeah, it's easy for me, but what if you're not? Mm-hmm. Just make it a miracle evening.
Yeah.
It needs to be the morning.
Yeah. So I do things that like set myself up for success, you know, before I finish up for the night. But my mornings with my baby, the chill, you know, cup That's of coffee, great. Sesame Street.
Sesame Street is important. Okay. We'll add Sesame Street to the habits for success.
Boom. There you go.
What about a tool, an internet resource, something you use every day? Or
a tool is like a really big conversation.
You need to pick one or two.
Well, I'll say a resource, because that would be easier, is Freelance to Freedom Project is Leah Kalamakis. And she really helped me get started in the beginning. She went from working a day job to running a web design business. She's a self-taught developer. And she has a ton of resources that are really laid out. I don't know if she's an introvert, but she seems kind of introverted to me. I'll have to ask her. But she helped me kind of lay out like my client intake process, those things that I was really nervous about. She helps you get started if there's someone that could use that resource. A favorite tool, you know, like Google everything, I think. I use Google apps, you know, Sheets and Drive and Numbers and the email, all of that stuff keeps me going all day long. So like the whole Google suite.
That's true. Yeah. I don't think we've mentioned those before. So forms and sheets,
exactly.
All of those things definitely worth checking out. And I'll make sure I link to the other site as well. What did you say it was?
Freelance to Freedom Project. There's a Facebook group and there's a website with a blog and she has courses and that kind of thing.
Awesome. And finally, a book that you would recommend to the Introvert Biz Growth audience.
I'm sure someone has said this, but Quiet by Susan Cain.
Yeah.
That was really good. Mm-hmm. I don't doubt it. I also am reading right now, it's a faith-based book, but it's called Call to Create by Jordan Rayner. And he is talking about, you know, people like C.S. Lewis, people that we know kind of in our world that we're creating something or entrepreneurial in nature. You know, the risks that they take and innovations that they set up, but talking about it from like a faith-based perspective, it's an interesting read. I don't think in my experience, there are only a handful of people I think that are kind of doing case studies on people from that perspective. So it's been an interesting read for me.
Wonderful. Okay. Make sure we link to those resources. And you also mentioned Lean In. So we'll definitely add that to the list as well.
She's my favorite.
Yeah.
She's my spirit animal.
For you. So definitely add that as well.
Yeah.
Well, we're coming to the end here, Julianne. It's been a great conversation. Thank you so much. We had, I think it's the first time we talked about also being a mom. And that's something that's obviously very close to my heart as well. So thanks for bringing that up. That was great. I always end with the mindful question. So what are you grateful for today or this week, Julianne?
Well, I think we've probably touched on a few of them. I did not break anything else than a finger. I'm very grateful for that. It would be this week or any other week. I'm just grateful, like you mentioned, for the chance to do this and to not have to compromise. You know, just the freedom of, I don't miss anything with my son. I get to still have this outlet with my clients. That's always at the top of my list anytime you ask me.
Great. Yeah. Likewise. Well, thanks so much for this conversation. It has been a great pleasure.
I'm glad to be here. Thanks.
I hope you enjoyed this conversation. To find out more about Julianne, go to juliannedesjardins.com. And she also has a Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/solopreneur strategy. And you'll find this episode's show notes at sarasenacroce.com/episode-48. Really highly encourage you to check that out. My podcast editor, Tim, and his team do an amazing job on the show notes. And it will include all the links to the resources we talk about, Julianne's favorite quote. So yeah, have a look and check that out. And as always, if you're listening to the show on a mobile device, you can click on the description and you'll actually find all the clickable links in there. And if you haven't downloaded my free beautiful compilation of 20 of the favorite books of my past podcast guests, you can go on and head over to sarasenacroce.com/books. Thanks so much for listening. This is Sarah Senacroce signing off from the Introvert Biz Growth Podcast. Remember, you need to use your unique introverted superpowers in order to make a difference.